welcome back to another episode of Planet Hunters Coffee Chat. I'm your host, Kassie Prolongo, and joining me, of course, is the wonderful Nora Eisner. Hey, Nora.
Hi, Kassie.
Good to see you. We had a nice little intro video, and now we're going to start diving into some interesting things for citizen scientists to use, but also resources that astronomers use, too. So today, we're going to be talking about something called, the acronym is called MAST, M-A-S-T, which stands for the Mikulski Archive for Space Telescopes. So let's talk a little bit about this and why it's so important, why astronomers use it, and what can citizen scientists do with this awesome resource?
So MAST, as you said, it's an archive and it hosts lots and lots of data. So if we want to interact with data more than we can, for example, on Planet Hunters tests, then we can go to the MAST archive and look at that data, we can download that data, or we can even just interact with the data on the site directly. So I think the best way to show MAST is just to look at it. So let's do that.
Let's do it.
Let me screen share.
Cool. Okay.
Cool. So when you go to this URL, which we will post underneath the video, you get to a site that looks like this. So this is the archive. And it's very easy. You have this box at the top here that says enter a TIC ID. Oh, sorry, it doesn't say that. It says enter a target. So we're going to enter a TIC ID here. So we have to, so these are the ID numbers that are for the test targets. So we have to just do TIC, which stands for test input catalog. So we have to tell MAST which catalog we are searching. Remember, this is lots of different telescopes, lots of different data is hosted on here. So we have to tell it which one to look for. And we can look at any target that we want. So for example, if you've been on Planet Hunters tests and you found a target that you particularly liked, underneath it, there's a little eye and you can click on that and that will tell you what the TIC ID of that target is. So I've pre-selected one. This is just a random TIC ID. You can choose whatever one you want. And I'm just going to copy and paste it into there. And then we press search. And well, this is always the moment where we find out how fast my computer is on a given day.
See what our internet speed is. And again, then we've got the three different columns. We've got the left-hand side, looks like some filtered functions, middle section. And then we've got a little viewfinder, it looks like, of the target, I'm guessing, of course. Yeah, that's really neat.
So this is really cool on the right here. It's just an image of what's around the target. And you can see our target is highlighted there in the middle with that cross. And we can zoom in on this as well. And there's the star that we're looking at. So that's pretty neat.
That's really neat.
But yeah, so there are three columns here. The one on the left just lets you filter for certain things. We're not going to worry about that too much because there's already so much on this site. So we will look at that maybe in the future. But for now, let's minimize this and focus on this middle column here. This is the important column that has all the information in it. So you can see here, this target that I selected, this is actually a target that has a known planet around it. So it's WASP-48b, I want to say. So because it's a known candidate, it's been observed by lots and lots of different instruments, lots of different telescopes. So if we just scroll down here, you can maybe see familiar names, and it's just an endless list of lots and lots of different observations. But we're just not going to worry about most of those for now. The only ones we're going to worry about for now are the TESS observations. So that's the data hosted on Planet Hunters TESS, of course, and we're just going to try and interact with that data a little bit more. Mm-hmm. So the way to find the TESS data is you go to this, you see this mission here at the top, and you just see which ones have TESS written in them. And the provenance name here is the SPOC pipeline. So this is the pipeline that processed the data. So this is what we're looking for. And you can see that. And more specifically, the ones that we care about for now are the ones that have this additional icon in addition to this kind of floppy disk that lets you download the data. This little graph here, the red graph, because that lets you directly interact with the data on the site, which is really cool. So it's called Time Series Viewer. We click on that and let's see what we can do.
So there were three different ones there. Do you just click on either one of them? Or, I mean, they're all just the same, I take it, or similar?
Yeah, that's a good question. So those are for three different test sectors. So if we think back to one of our previous videos, we talked about how TESS observes the different stars in the sky in different sectors. So there are three, it's been observed in three sectors, and you can just click on any one of those at a time. All right, I'm going to make this a bit bigger so we can see this better. Okay, cool. So this is the data, and you might see this light curve and you might think this looks quite messy. This is not what I'm used to seeing on, we'll go to full zoom here. This is not what I'm used to seeing on Planet Hunter's tests. And that's because the data that we're looking at here is the SAP data. So this stands for Simple Aperture Photometry. And that's that blue one that you can see on the right here. But the one that we actually want to be looking at is the PDC SAP flux. So if we click on that here, we can see them both appear, and you can see the comparison between the two. If we go to full zoom again, you can see that this orange one is much, much flatter and doesn't have this data that's introduced by the test satellite. So what I'm trying to say is that the orange one is much more processed. It's been cleaned up, it's much more tidy, and much, much easier to look at. So actually, let's just completely get rid of that blue one for the time being.
So to reiterate, the blue is what's come down from the satellite. So it is the unprocessed raw data. And then the yellow, this what we're looking at now, is what's gone through the pipeline, which is like an algorithm, and people have cleaned this up. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
So you can see this is already much, much nicer. Much more what we want. So let's look at that left-hand column. So I've already been playing around with these buttons on the left a little bit. I've pressed full zoom just to get a nicer view of the data. But let's go to this options tab here. And what we can do here, we can play around with some more parameters. So the smoothing factor here, for example, we can increase this a little bit, and you'll see some of the data. You can see it's just looking a bit tidier. It just gets rid of some of that scatter there. So the smoothing factor here is what in later episodes I will call the binning factor or binning. So we'll cover what that is and how to use that in the future. But if you go on MAST, do play around with that and see what happens if you increase this number too much. Another thing we can look at.
Do you break it if you increase it too much?
I'm not going to spoil it now. You're going to have to try it yourself.
You have to try it at home, and don't worry, you won't break it. I'm just kidding. All right, go ahead.
Well, we'll see what happens.
Yeah.
And then the other thing you can play around with is the style. You can make it lines, you can make it points. I don't really like the lines. I much prefer the points. I would encourage you to play around with that and see what you can do. All right.
The points is more clear. You can see like the dip for each one. The line sort of looks like it's all, I don't know, looks kind of weirdly connected. That's a personal preference thing. Yeah.
Yeah, that's definitely personal really preference. Cool. Points are better.
Yeah. Okay, good. So I'm less terrified now to go through and, oh my God, am I going to break something or whatever, but it's just going through and actually doing cool stuff with the data that's already been gone through the process pipeline. Is there anything else on the MAST that you think would be good for people to go through or to learn in the early stages or even more advanced stages very quickly, you think?
Let's very quickly also look at phase folding. So this is also something we'll talk about more in the future, but we'll show how you can do this on MAST itself. So if you remember back to, again, one of the previous episodes, we talked about phase folding and how that folds multiple of those dips, of those transit events on top of one another, to build up that signal. So we need a couple of parameters in order to do that. Well, in this case, we just need one parameter. We need to know the orbital period. So we need to tell the code or this algorithm how to chop up this light curve and how to fold that on top of each other. So we need to know the orbital period. So that's the duration of a year on that planet, how long that planet takes to orbit around its star. So you don't need to know this orbital period. I have just looked this up, so I know what it is. And I know it's 2.14363. We'll find out in a moment if that's correct.
So good memory, Nora.
Sorry?
Good memory.
No, it's sneakily hidden on my computer. So we then just press enable phase folding. And there we go. Yeah, so phase folding is really good to, if you have multiple transit events, to put them on top of each other to build up that signal. So once you have phase folded, you can, for example, zoom in on it by drawing a box over it like this. And you can just see, you can really start seeing the shape of this transit. And once you have the shape, you can determine parameters such as how large this planet is. That's a good parameter.
Right. Okay, cool. Now you knew what the period of days was for this. How would other people look up that information? Or is that something that we can do on a future episode?
So you can either determine what the orbital period is. So if it's not a known planet and you can't look it up, then you can determine it yourself. And we'll cover that, or we'll cover how to do that in future episodes. And what we'll also cover in the very next episode is how to look it up on something called ExoFOP. So ExoFOP has a lot of information on a lot of different targets. So if it's a known system, you can look it up on there. So we'll cover that in the next episode.
Cool. Okay, that sounds good. All right. Well, thank you, Nora, for getting us started looking through MAST. So I encourage all of you at home to go through, have a play with it. Let us know what you think. If there's anything that you want, maybe that's a little bit more of an advanced manipulation of data that you want Nora and I to take a look at, you know, give us a comment, let us know. And yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Okay, ExoFOP is our next one. So stay tuned for our next episode. Thank you so much, Nora.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.